Hello, everyone, and welcome to One Fantastic Rogue Beast, a marvelous mashup, the roundtable of six of us here from Signum. I didn't even plan all that alliteration, in which we talk about fantastic beasts and where to find them, and Rogue One. So welcome, all of you. We're very glad to have you here. I also want to let you know that we are streaming this on Twitch as well, so if that's your preferred venue, you can watch it over on the Twitch stream also, or instead. Right. So in a moment, I'm going to introduce all of these lovely people to you. But first of all, a couple of announcements. There are some other exciting events coming up at Signum soon. One of the most noteworthy is Tom Shippey's seminar on Tolkien's Beowulf. So this is an awesome program that you don't want to miss. It's sort of a mini course. Missed Tom Shippey's Beowulf course, or even if you took it, this is a different perspective on Tolkien's translation and commentary on Beowulf with one of the leading scholars on both Anglo-Saxon literature and on Tolkien. So this is a three-class seminar. So it's three Thursday afternoons in January, starting on the 12th. So check out signumuniversity.org events page to find more details on that. So that's the main event coming up. I just want to let everybody know that if you like this program and are happy to get more programs like this, you could donate to Signum University, signumuniversity.org/fund/donate. I'm going to try to send you all that link right now in your chat box. So hopefully you got that. If that worked, that came through all right. Do we have any other announcements we want to make? Any other events coming up that I don't know about? I mean, we have spring classes starting in a week, right? Is that what you were going to say, Curtis?
It is, yes.
So check out our wonderful lineup of spring classes. I'm particularly excited about the research methods course, which shows you where my priorities are. But this is a great class in how to read, how to write, and the big ideas that people bring to literature. So you might want to check that one out. Thank you, Neil. Exploring Middle Earth on Tuesdays, a new endeavor that Professor Olson has launched. So check that out as well. A question came through. We'll be monitoring Twitch chat for questions, too. I will not. I don't know if any of you are set up that you can multitask with that. If not, feel free to do that amongst yourselves. That would be great. Let me see if I can let you view the attendees list. There you are. You should have it now, Erica. All right, well, let me introduce this beautiful and brilliant panel to you. In alphabetical order by last name, we have Brenton Dickieson. Brenton is on the faculty here at Signum. He is working on a PhD on the theology of C.S. Lewis's fictional worlds, and he writes the blog A Pilgrim in Narnia. He lives in the almost fictional land of Prince Edward Island, where he teaches and consults in higher education. So thanks for being here with us tonight, Brenton.
Hello.
Hey, Kelly, Orazi or Orazi?
Orazi.
Orazi, okay. Kelly is a longtime bookseller, reader, and Signum student. She spends her days reading Harry Potter, pretending she has the Force, and hanging out with her dog, Lupin. Does he turn into a werewolf when the moon shines on him?
He's a wolf. He's just crazy. He may as well be a wolf.
Okay.
Excellent. She's descended from a real-life wand maker, but has yet to embark on the journey of making her lightsaber, so you want to get on that soon. Kat Sass recently submitted her final MA thesis for Signum University, yay, where she completed her degree concentrating in imaginative literature. She knows a lot more about Harry Potter than Star Wars, but looks forward to discussing both movies. Look forward to that too. Emily Strand is a professor of comparative religions at Mount Carmel College of Nursing in Columbus, Ohio, where she also serves the Catholic Diocese as a master catechist. Besides books on liturgy, she's published articles on Harry Potter, including one for the book Harry Potter for Nerds 2, is a staff writer at HogwartsProfessor.com, and has appeared on the MuggleNet Academia podcast. And you blame Amy Sturgis for your obsession with Star Wars. Very good.
Entirely.
All her fault, and we're glad. And Curtis Weyant was born in the year of the Force, making him a chosen one of some kind or other, although of what type we see him exactly. He has read most of the Star Wars legend stories before they were legends, and is happy enough people have finally seen Rogue One that he can talk about it without having to avoid spoilers. which just is a warning to all of you that we will be spoiling everything this afternoon. Everything that we're going to talk about, we're just going to go ahead and spoil it all, because we want to be able to talk about things like narrative arcs, you know, where they go, where they fit overall, the spirit of the endings. So just fair warning for that. So we thought it would be a good idea to start with some quick little plot summaries, because we thought that some of you may have seen one of these two films, but not the other. So Kelly is going to start us out with a plot summary of Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. Not so much like where it fits in the world or anything. Just tell us sort of the premise and the story of this film, please.
Okay, so it is about Newt Scamander, author of Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, who is a magizoologist, I think is kind of the right word for it. He studies animals, magical creatures, and is on a journey to study them and free some of them that he has in his magical suitcase, where he keeps animals and helps them, and he travels to America and teams up with a nomad or a muggle, Jacob, Tina, and Queenie, two brilliant sisters who are witches. And throughout the movie, there is the daunting rise of Grindelwald, the evil wizard before Voldemort, and it all accumulates to a big dark ending. It's a fun movie.
Yeah, well done. Great. Anybody want to add something into that at all before we get the summary of Rogue One? Okay. All right, so Emily, you want to do something similar for us for Rogue One then?
Yes, indeed, in a totally different way. So the best way to understand the premise of Rogue One is to think about A New Hope, which is the original 1977 Star Wars film, and to realize that as it opens, the rebels have just become in possession of plans for this ultimate super weapon that the Empire is building, and the Empire is pursuing them across the galaxy, trying to retrieve these plans. The question becomes, how did they get these plans? Where did they steal these plans from? Who stole the plans? And how did the rebels come to have them, to possess them? So Rogue One answers these questions. So you meet this band of rebels who call themselves Rogue One for various reasons, led by a girl named Jyn Erso. She's 18 to 20 years old, and she is the daughter of the brilliant scientist Galen Erso, who actually was sort of enslaved to the Empire to design the Death Star. So the plot becomes Jyn's desire and her quest to find her father and to rescue him, but also then she forms this rogue band to steal these Death Star plans. And of course, we know, hardcore Star Wars fans or any Star Wars fans know, we don't know these characters moving forward in the franchise. So in fact, even as the film opens, somebody who's in the know enough can realize that these characters do not survive this ordeal of stealing the Death Star plans.
Right. Yep. Well done. We might come back to this in a minute after we do some other things to fit them in, but I'm fascinated by how both films have these little material concerns, like don't lose your luggage and how can you increase your home network connectivity. Right? We'll come back to those in a minute. All right, very well done. So then the questions rise of where these fit into their worlds and into our world. So, Kat, where does Fantastic Beasts fit from our perspective, from like the other movies and the other books, where things have been published and released?
Sure. So you said within their worlds and within our world, so kind of taking the primary, our world, first. Fantastic Beasts, the movie, is based on Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, which is a short book that J.K. Rowling wrote in 2001. She published the Harry Potter school books. So it's, copies of Harry's textbooks. So you get Fantastic Beasts and Quidditch Through the Ages. And they're the books that he has in school, and then in the marginalia you see, his notes and, jokes that he and Ron scribble to each other and that sort of thing. And they're sort of in between Harry Potter books. She wrote these and all the proceeds went to charity, I think. So that's sort of what it's based on, at least the premise of Newt Scamander as this magizoologist, although the story of the movie is not in that book in any form, really. So the movie obviously just came out this year, and they also published a rolling screenplay along with it, which I think is the first screenplay that she's written herself. So, you know, you can sort of go buy that in the bookstore as well. And then there's a planned series of 5 movies now. I think it used to be 3, but now we're up to 5. So that's coming down the pike. And then in the secondary world, the world of the story, it takes place in 1926, so 70-ish years before the events of Harry Potter, because that series mostly takes place in the 90s. And so, you know, there's some characters, you know, you kind of hear about Dumbledore's out there somewhere, but you don't really, you don't ever see him. They're sort of on the periphery. Kelly mentioned that Grindelwald plays a part, who is somebody on the periphery of the Harry Potter series as this sort of precursor to Voldemort, you know, the kind of dark wizard that predated him by a certain number of years. And the impression you get in the Harry Potter books is that Grindelwald really rose up during the 30s and 40s. And so you have this idea of it's this magical fascism that's parallel to, you know, the fascist movements that kind of were in the world between the World Wars and in the World War II period. So this this movie's sort of set right at the cusp of that. You know, Grindelwald is sort of about to become a really big menace, you know, just around the same time that those sorts of things are happening in, you know, the non-magical world. So that's the context of it.
Good, good. Well, I'm going to ask another question on that, and then hang on, Curtis, we'll get to you for the where Rogue One fits. But Kat, or anybody, what sense do we get of how much Harry would have known this story? And there's a bunch of different ways we could answer that, right?
Jeez.
Because it's kind of like reverse engineered, if that's the right phrase.
Which book do you mean? Because at the beginning, of course, he doesn't know anything, right?
Right,
Like, where within the Hogwarts curriculum did they read the Fantastic Beasts?
Do we know that?
Well, he starts taking care of magical creatures in book 3.
Yeah.
So, but again, I don't know that there's no narrative in Fantastic Beasts. It's a bestiary. You know, it says, like, you know, this is a Niffler, and here's what it does, and here's its magical properties, and here's its level of danger on a scale of, like, 1 to 5 or something, and how to take care of it. So, I mean, it's hard to say how much you would have known about the historical context of it, just because this is totally, like, a retcon story, and so, like, it didn't exist when, I mean, Grindelwald exists, but all this stuff
in New York. The other, my question was not what could Harry have known about it, because when Harry was being written, this story didn't exist, so we have to retroactively fit it. Erica made the point maybe they would have learned about it in History of Magic, and Neil said Hermione probably read about it in a magic history book.
But no one listened in History of Magic, right? I don't think anyone learned anything in History of Magic except Hermione for at least the 7-year framework, right? So who's a bad teacher? So I don't think anyone... I mean, we hear less about
what they were actually learning and studying, but we'll come back to that. Emily, did you want to add something on that question?
Yeah, somebody from Hogwarts Professor, I can't remember if it was Louise or Elizabeth, pointed out that Harry, or whoever's making the marginal notes in Fantastic Beasts, on page 14, Roman numeral 14, they circle, the title is A Brief History of Muggle Awareness of Fantastic Beasts, and they've circled brief, and they've put you liar. And so clearly somebody knows that Newt is a liar. So that's one thing I think we have to think about moving forward. Well, at least we know Newt is a liar. So if he's not really here in America to shop for fancy puff skeins or whatever, then at least we heard it here first. You know, we heard it in this little textbook first.
Which brings all kinds of great questions about unreliable narrators.
Yeah. I thought the liar was the short part. It wasn't a short introduction.
Well, I agree, but it could be a double entendre.
high school students would say, right?
Right. She could retcon it to mean more than it meant when she wrote it, you know?
Exactly.
And so now there's a new layer to it, yeah.
Which is part of fun. Yeah. Okay, well, we'll come back to some of these questions, and Kate, I intend to come to that question soon, so thank you for asking it. So, Curtis, similarly, in primary world and secondary world terms, where does Rogue One fit?
Yeah.
Brief.
So, yeah.
No, not brief.
Well, so, it's interesting in a way, because, of course, Star Wars came out 40 years ago now, the original. When I say Star Wars, of course, I mean A New Hope. But it was only known as Star Wars when it first came out. So in one sense, it's literally the biggest gap you can have between two consecutive stories in that universe. And they are literally consecutive because, as it turns out, where Rogue One ends is pretty much like minutes from where, you know, A New Hope picks up. As Emily points out, like, you basically get, like, it's interesting because, like, the scroll-up in A New Hope almost becomes, like, a, you know, previously seen on Star Wars. Like, this is what happened. Here's a little recap. Of course, you know, they didn't have that recap in 1977. We only get it now. So that's the sort of primary world story. Of course, you know, there were other movies, but they were all in sort of what I call this the Skywalker saga, right? They're all about sort of the Skywalker family and their story. And this is the first time that we get a movie that doesn't follow that family story. Now, when you turn to Star Wars media, of course, there's a lot of it out there, and much of it has been sort of swept away into what's now referred to as legend story. But just sticking with the canonical stuff, just in the last few years, Lucasfilm, under Disney's aegis, has been producing a lot of material that actually occurs between the last film chronologically, which would be Revenge of the Sith, and now Rogue One. And within that, sort of the first novel, actually, of this sort of new setup was A New Dawn by John Jackson Miller, which we looked at in Dr. Sturgis's class. And that sets up the characters for the CGI show, Star Wars Rebels, which I really have enjoyed, actually. And the third season returns tomorrow, I believe, so looking forward to that. But, you know, without getting into details, that story really talks a lot of, you know, shows a lot of the story behind the buildup of the rebel movement and, you know, how it gets to this point of, you know, where people actually start believing, like, oh, hey, maybe we can fight this big empire that's just seems vast and overbearing and all of that. So Rogue One kind of fits in there. In the scroll-up to the original Star Wars, you know, it says that the Rebellion has just won its first major victory, and, you know, this is it. Rogue One is that victory. And just one other little piece is there's actually a book that's sort of the prologue to the prologue, if you will, of it called Catalyst, that tells the story of Jin's parents and sort of, as Emily alluded to, you know, how Galen sort of becomes enslaved and is forced to work on the power of the Death Star and all of that. So
these worlds are continuing to expand, and they're expandable. I mean, I remember when I read Fantastic Beasts that I had this sort of little sense of a story in the back of my head, that even though it's written like an encyclopedia, or as Kat said, more properly, a bestiary, you're getting all these hints like, well, where did he catch all of these? You know, how did he study them? You know, is he a National Geographic photographer in the magical world? You know, and then similarly with Rogue One, I really wanted to know the backstory of Jin's parents. So we have the expanded universe aspects of both of these. So Brenton, why don't you jump off of that then? More kind of theoretical stuff about the making of secondary worlds, and yeah, take us where you want to with that.
Yeah, I actually might not go too far. I kind of think that's the way the discussion's going to go anyway, based on the introductions that we've heard, right? I think each of the panelists here are pretty much interested in not just the story as narrative, but the story that either intersects with our world sort of culturally, or it intersects with other worlds. But maybe I'll just say one thing. So, does anybody watch the old trailers for the original Star Wars series? Right. So if you go to the New Hope trailer, it's amazing. It starts off with like a rolling epic, a billion years in the making. It's this huge.
Oh, I think we just lost your sound. Is anybody else?
It looked really intriguing what you were saying, but we couldn't hear.
Yeah, no, we lost you in the middle of that. Oh, no. Try it again now, Brenton. Yeah, there you are.
Are we back here?
Yep. We're back.
Do you have audio? Okay, sorry about that. Yeah, I was just doing a sound effects, so, and they were awesome. But I'm not going to repeat.
We missed your Darth Vader breathing.
Blew your sound.
So the... that was actually dramatic tension. The original trailer had this idea of this epic, this huge space saga that was the size was the issue, length of time was the issue, it was this huge world. And so I've been just kind of thinking about that and thinking about what happened with the new Harry Potter world movie. I don't know what to call it except the Harry Potter world, I guess. And so what we have, I think, with Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them is this response to fan desire for a bigger world, is to fill out and to make the Harry Potter universe bigger. And to kind of, I was kind of disappointed with the Fantastic Beasts book as I read it, but now to see some of those creatures come to life and to kind of play with the different, the strength of that world. And the Harry Potter books are very British oriented. It's very much on the Isles with a little bit of Europe, right? And then to kind of have that kind of move out, what's the wizarding community like globally, which is what the Fantastic Beasts book does. It actually pops us out into the different continents. So we get a world that gets bigger, right, with the Fantastic Beasts movie. I think, though, with the with Rogue One, and I have a lot of good to say with it, so it's not a negative thing. I actually think we're seeing the Star Wars universe kind of get smaller as we add to it. It's actually narrowing in on these spaces. I thought actually both introductions are great, but Curtis, the roll up thing, right? To insert, like, so we've got an insertion of, you know, a whole movie, a 2-hour movie that's inserted into just a couple of words within the first, you know, yellow scroll on the screen, and it actually, like, the movement between the different galaxies actually kind of gets quicker. You know, everything's happening immediately. We have things that are hopping on top of one another, including the Force Awakens insertion, and so these two kind of insertions, the Fantastic Beasts insertion and the Rogue One insertion, they kind of move pretty well into those worlds, but I think they do opposite thing. One makes the world bigger, and I think one makes that world smaller. So I think that's what I would start with, just as an introduction. I think we'll end up talking about kind of how these worlds come about and what those things mean anyway. So.
Yeah. Erica adds to that we're introduced to 5 or so planets in about 5 minutes.
That's right. Bam, so, bam, bam, bam.
Kind of like double-clicking, right? So we had the original movies, and then we sort of double-click on just one little tiny moment or one little phrase, right. And we look at that in its own window, so to speak.
But they were even labeled. At least they were labeled.
They're labeled, yeah. Unlike, usually they're not. That's one thing, too, is in those awful first 3 movies, what we got when we went to a new world is we saw the world, and then we saw these huge expansive cities, and then we kind of narrowed in. Now in this world, we come, and we're immediately on a planet, and we're immediately on a base or a village or a little tiny city. There's even a narrowing in the visual reality. We don't see any of those maps that pull out the galaxies, right, that we see in all the other films. And so I think there is a smallening of these worlds that I think to its credit in this case.
Probably says me now. There was some good stuff in the prequels.
Oh, well, yeah, no prequel hating. No prequel haters.
There was.
Are you sure, Emily?
There was lots of good stuff in the prequels, but I have to tell you, my relief in Rogue One was kind of washed over me watching the film. I was just relieved.
And I think there might be a genre reason for that too, as well as sort of other technical storytelling and cinematographic reasons. We'll get to that. Okay, so here's a question. I'll ask it about Fantastic Beasts first. Suppose there are going to be 5 Fantastic Beast movies, right? When they're all made, in what order do I read all the books, and in what order do I watch all the movies?
Good question. Yeah.
Should I?
In what order do you... Why would your book reading change?
Do I stop and read Fantastic Beasts when I'm in the middle of Book 3 of Harry Potter, when they would have read it? Or do I read it first before I start the 7 books?
You know, it might be fun to read first, just, well, at least maybe after Book 1, maybe?
Yeah.
Because what it does, the book at least, is just, as you said, is just a listing and about the magical creatures in the world. And that might have been fun to have when you're reading the series for the very first time, or just again and again, because those creatures come up, and it'd be fun to kind of know their backstory and a little bit more about them than just what you learn in the Harry Potter books, because we don't get to go to magical care of magical creatures, and I'm not bitter about that at all. But I mean, this kind of is our introduction to that, so it might be kind of fun after Book 1, but I don't think it changes the game that much, and I don't think it changes the game in how you watch their films either, because I just see them as wholly separate, and it's part of that's because it's a whole different villain, and Voldemort, I think, was influenced by Grindelwald, and probably could not have done what he did without knowing that someone came before him and did those things, which those things I don't know yet because we haven't seen all 5 films, but I see them, to me, as separate. I don't know if the same goes for you guys.
Okay. And Erica is also asking along those lines, do we know what the 5 films are going to be about? Is there a continuing storyline with Newt Scamander? And I have another question while you're all pondering that. Well, so what about the screenplay? Like, should I read the screenplay first because it's the backstory and then read the Harry Potter series?
There is
you
almost
should buy
nothing.
The
thing.
How pretty it is.
So,
Kelly, answer me this, though. Is there any, because I've heard that there isn't anything in the screenplay that you don't learn from a close watch of the film. I mean, maybe some clarification on the end and Credence's fate. That's possibly what it gives you if you miss that in the film, because that is very subtle, the fact that Credence actually survives and escapes out of the subway. That's a little bit more clear in the but unlike novelizations of the Star Wars films, you know, where you do actually get almost like deleted scenes or additional content, additional backstory, you know, I didn't even end up buying the screenplay for Fantastic Beasts because I just, you know, first of all, I don't think I should have to read a screenplay to be able to understand a film. And secondly, I heard that there was nothing additional to it. Kelly, would you agree with that or would you disagree?
I am a little bit more than halfway through reading it. And I wasn't sure if I was going to buy it either, but mostly just because it's very, very pretty and I like
it in
books.
Pretty.
And even inside, it's got, like, you know, they did it well.
Okay.
The added bits are the stage directions, right? What Jacob might be thinking, what Newt is thinking before he speaks, the kind of directions towards the actors, which, and I've never read screenplays, so I don't know. I mean, all screenplays have this, right? but that is what I found most interesting. Descriptions, even of like Queenie, like she's described as the most beautiful witch to ever. What was it? She's described in this. It just. Oh, here we go. Blonde Queenie, the most beautiful girl ever to don witch's robes. You know, it's just, that's kind of fun. And that sort of difference I really like.
On
a similar note, I'm reading Rogue One, too, and there's not a ton of, I don't know if you guys have read the novelization of it, maybe Kurt.
No.
But there's not too many scenes that are, like, blowing my mind of, oh my gosh, this is different and I didn't get this. But there's some cool characterization, like you get some inside characters' minds thing, just like you do in the screenplay of Fantastic Beasts.
If I can jump in, I think what's a bit more interesting than, like, do we get extra material, whatever, is the matter of a reader's, a viewer's first introduction to the world. And John Stanifer made the comment, it's the Narnia debate over again. Well, that's why I asked it, John. Yeah. Because the question in Narnia is, what is the best introduction to the tone, to the kappa element, right, to the Lewisian Michael Ward term, the donegality of this world, right? And would you all agree that probably reading the screenplay or reading Fantastic Beasts itself is not what we want? I mean, we want to be under the staircase, we want to be getting our letter, we want to be invited into Hogwarts, yes?
Yeah, can I? Well, I was going to say the same thing, that, like, I mean, it's, I think sometimes it's fun to do the thought experiment of, I'm going to read everything in internal chronological order just for the heck of it, like, to do. But I would, like, that's a fun thing once you're familiar with something and you want to see, all right, if I rearrange the pieces, what new insights do I get by doing that? But in general, I kind of feel like the order in which it was published, produced, whatever, is, like, you know, not the official version, it's nothing that serious, but, like, the best form of presentation, whether it's, you know, the Narnia Chronicles or, like, I would say, you know, putting, you know, the Potter films and books in the order in which they came out is probably the most, just because, like, even if you find out later information that's backstory, it's still not, you're not following a train of thought of how it was conceived. And I feel like going in the order that it came is just more, I don't know, it has more of a flow to it.
Well, for the sake of pushing us along, because there are lots of other topics we want to cover, what about Star Wars? What order should we watch all of those in? While you're thinking, Han sent in his order. Rogue One and A New Hope, Empire Strikes Back, Revenge of the Sith, Return of the Jedi, and The Force Awakens is my order.
So leaving out the prequels altogether?
Yeah.
prequels do not exist, Erica.
And I'm not saying that's a bad idea, but...
I am.
I actually think, yeah, this might be the first time where I would agree with watching a newer movie before... So sort of, I think generally I agree with Kat where, you know, watching or reading things in sort of the order they're produced is a good way to approach it, because I feel like you're always going to have those references in the later produced movies. And I think both in both Fantastic Beasts and in Rogue One, you get that. So in Rogue One, right, you have like K2 getting ready to say, I have a bad feeling about this, and then getting cut off. And that's... That's only, right, sorry, spoilers, guys. But that's only funny because you know that they say that in every other movie. And you wouldn't get that if your first movie was Rogue One. Now, you know, hopefully if you watch Rogue One and then all the others, and then you go back and you say, okay, now I get it. But I don't know, I feel like you lose a little something that way. But I feel, for Rogue One specifically, I feel like it's a good enough movie. I don't think it's a standalone movie, and a lot of like press has called it that, and Tom Hillman and I were going back and forth on Twitter today about what to call Rogue One, as far as like...
Insertion.
You know, is it a prequel? Is it a, you know, prologue, is what Dr. Sturgis suggested? You know, is it a standalone movie? Is it an anthology movie? I mean, it's kind of all of those things, but none of them on its own. But I feel like it does tell a good enough story that it can be the starting point to the Star Wars series, which is the only time I've ever felt that way about a movie that wasn't A New Hope.
I want to give our audience a chance to put in their comments, and then I'll call on you, Emily. Casey says, watch 4, 5, 6, oops, your comment just jumped, 4, 5, 6, 7, Rogue One, and don't watch 1, 2, and 3. Kelly says, nope, watch them in release order, then in universe chronological, including Clone Wars and Rebels and about 500 books. We do have some people saying the prequels are great, and other people saying the prequels do not exist. So, Emily, what were you going to say?
Well, I mean, I agree with release order. about this, and so I'm kind of, you know, I'm a book nerd. I'm not really a film person. I blame Amy Sturgis for all this. My you know, low grade obsession is all her fault. But in
good
terms
news,
of
there's lots of books though too.
Yeah, that's true. I know. So it sustained my obsession. So I come to movies not as an expert. I come to movies as just an appreciator and a viewer. And Star Wars, and I didn't have any baggage when I first watched Star Wars, but I would have watched, first of all, if I would have watched the prequels first, I mean, as much as I love the prequels, I probably wouldn't have kept watching. But because I watched them in the release order, you know, starting with A New Hope and going through and then back and then forward and then back again, you know, with the advances in technology in terms of the filmmaking, I think if I would have watched Rogue One before I watched A New Hope would have looked like an old-fashioned movie to me. And that's not, I mean, it kind of is an old-fashioned movie at this point. And so I don't think that's a good idea for viewers. I think you know, you need to move forward as the films progress, you know, both in our history, more in our history than in the Star Wars history, and just appreciate it in the kind of hodgepodge way it kind of shakes out when you do that.
Yeah. Let's go in on this, or maybe I should say double click on this that we were talking earlier. Let's talk about one changes the way we watch episode 4 now. Right? I mean, I would say it certainly adds deeper poignancy, and they did that with the overlap scenes at the end of Rogue One. They made us watch those scenes differently now. Right?
Yeah.
What else does it do, Curtis?
Well, so starting there, so for me, the first time I saw Rogue One, to see that scene where you have Darth Vader sort of storming through the ship, the Rebel ship, and just like cutting down left and right, throwing Rebels against the wall, and you know, like three steps ahead of him is, you know, the guy running with the disc and then, like, handing it to the next guy running with the disc right before he gets cut down and then handing, and then, like, passing it through the door that won't open all the way. For me, that, to go from there and then right to the beginning of A New Hope where you have, you know, those rebels sitting there in the hallway as, like, the smoke comes through and, like, you hear the sounds of, you know, Vader and the stormtroopers coming into the ship, it just makes it that much more darker for me. And I'll be honest, so to bring in some prequel hate here, those, like, seeing Darth Vader go through and just sort of cutting down these nameless rebels who I don't really have a reason to care about was way more effective for me than, like, the scene where you have Anakin in Revenge of the Sith going into the Jedi Temple and there's a bunch of kids there, and you know that he kills them, you don't see it. But, like, just from an acting, I know I'm a terrible person, and you can hate me for, like, thinking that that's, you know, not effective or whatever. But it just, I don't know. It's the acting. It's the tone. It's all of the above that for me just makes that a much darker and I think realistic idea of what, like, a rebellion actually is. And I think that's what I like a lot about Rogue One. In general, is that it gives you that darker side. So I know we've got questions about some of those darker things in the movie itself as well, but I would leave it there, and I'll let someone else talk.
Yeah, we do. We have some comments and questions about that, but I also anybody want to respond immediately to what Curtis said? Emily, you looked like maybe you wanted to respond to that.
Oh, no. I mean, I think I agree. I think I agree with all that. Yeah. I'll give it a thumbs up.
All right, Erica agrees with you, Hans agrees with you, Mark says I watched 4 right after Rogue One, and it was very enlightening to watch it that way. And Tony says, I definitely think it changes the way we see the destruction of the Death Star. Instead of being a dumb mistake, it's a sabotage plot from the beginning. Yeah, so that deepens that aspect of it more, doesn't it? Now, what about the ending of Rogue One? So this is our major, major spoiler time, so if you haven't seen it, you might want to switch off your audio for a couple minutes. So let's talk about the ending of Rogue One in some detail and discuss whether it is a tragedy, and maybe each of you can share some definitions of tragedy, like what's a classical tragedy and various other kinds of tragedy you've come across, and does it fit? Brenton, you want to come in on that?
Sure. I mean, I'll just do the most sort of lame approach, is imagining, you know, comedy as a U-shape and tragedy as just a downward slope. If we just use that in that kind of Aristotle poetics kind of way, it's a comedy, right? Because it loops back into the world, right? So if when that chip gets into the right hands, into Carrie Fisher robotic visual image hands, right? That moment there is actually the complete loop up. So it's now a U shape instead of a slide down. I mean, there's a lot of courage and it's intriguing what they did in the film, and kind of keeps a lot of problems from emerging, right? In conflicts of worlds that are inserted, the characters that just disappear forever for no reason. Well, now there's a reason. So I think so. That's, I think it's a comedy.
Okay.
I was thinking the same thing. I mean, I don't know that I hadn't used the word comedy in my head, but I thought, you know, the kind of reversal of fortune there, of the characters go on an upward trend, even though it ends in death. It, you know, they start out without purpose, without fulfillment, without, you know, direction or anything. And there's a kind of, the spirit at the end is one of triumph for them, even if, and so both on a, it's an upward trend both for the group that, okay, we've now, you know, rescued these plans and we're escaping with them, but also for the individual characters. They both start out, I think, at a higher place than where they, or they end higher than they begin.
Good.
And the characters don't fail because of a tragic flaw. They succeed in spite of their tragic flaws. And I think that's, I mean, I don't have any specific definition of tragic, you know, tragedy or whatever in mind, but I think that, you know, looking at it as this isn't a failure of human capacity. It's a success. It's, you know, meant to be that, you know, they did it. They made it. Yes, they died in the end, but it was a sacrifice. It wasn't attempting to do something that they failed at.
Right.
Yeah, I think that...
Go ahead, Emily, and then I'll jump in with something.
I was just going to agree with Curtis and say, you know, this, they didn't fail. This is, their lives are what the task required. And it's a new kind of sacrifice. You know, Cassian has sacrificed, you know, his humanity along the way in his service of the rebellion, and that this has made him a deeply unhappy person. But in you know, kind of feeding off of Jin's sense of hope, you know, he comes to realize, he kind of purifies his sacrifice and realizes that what's really needed is his own life. And this is a very hopeful thing. I mean, you know, that scene with them on the beach, you know, kind of embracing each other on the beach, it looks like a sunrise, what's coming for them. Mm-hmm. And really the sun is rising on a new day for the rebels, and this is what Cassian wants. So yeah, I'll agree. I'm not an expert on what is tragedy and what's not, but I would definitely agree that this is not it.
Right. A lot of our listeners, viewers here have been agreeing. Tony says, Jin and Cassian at the end on the beach remind me of Frodo and Sam on the slopes of Mount Doom, except that in this case, they are not miraculously rescued. And Jacob says, it's something that needed to happen. It was a suicide mission, but he also mentions the term eucatastrophe. Let's come back to that in a second, see if we think it was a eucatastrophe. Mark says, anything that ends with hope is a classic comedy. And Hans points out that Jin's message of hope is actually Cassian's message as well.
Yeah.
So classical definition of tragedy, Aristotle's definition, was that it brought about a catharsis or a release in the spectators by arousing sensations of pity and fear and then purging them of those emotions. Does that happen? I mean, did you have pity and fear aroused in you in watching Rogue One, and then were those cleansed or purged?
I was sad when K2 died. No, I actually meant that. Like,
I
for me,
I thought that was a bit more emotional than.
And honestly, it was that moment, like the second time he gets shot or whatever, and you're like, oh, he's not going to make it, and actually, maybe some of them aren't going to make it. Now, first time through, I didn't realize they were all not going to make it, but I agree. Like, at that moment, you're like, oh, wow, that's different, because you don't, like, how many times do we see, like, C-3PO throughout the series, losing various parts of himself, and he never dies. He always comes back, right? Like, put together, and right, like half of Empire Strikes Back, he's in pieces,
in a box.
You know, dismembered. Yeah, so you don't actually ever expect
him. Hans and Erica have been saying sort of similar complimentary things here that I want to push out a little bit. Hans says he thinks it's okay that the Rogue One team died because to me they didn't feel like they had more development to give. There's always room for the development, but they all accomplished their arcs in a satisfying way, except K2. But he didn't ever have an arc except to be hilarious and awesome at the same time. But Erica said that she thought one of the flaws in the film was that she had a hard time caring about any of them. So I agree with that, Erica, and I'd be interested to hear other people's perspectives. I had a very hard time connecting with the characters, and the film spent so long giving us little clips of many, many different places and people and things, and was honestly just completely confusing. Couldn't understand it all until about half an hour in. And so that took away from the power of the ending to me. Somebody has some background. Let me figure out who that is. Giving us some fuzzy noises there. No, it's okay now. I don't know who it was. So what do we think?
Can I disagree with that? Oh, go ahead, Kelly. No, you go ahead.
Kelly.
I was going to say, I thought it was very character-driven. I don't know if you were thinking the same thing, Emily. But for me, I cared so much. The fact that each character got their own moment of death, I mean, how could you not, I don't know how to pronounce his name, Chirrut? How could you not care about him? Oh, my goodness. I mean, that death scene, really? Oh, my gosh. I thought he was great, and I thought the fact that you care that K2 died, he's a machine, and I know that we, the Star Wars universe, care so much about R2, and maybe even BB-8 now is everyone's favorite, so that's nothing new, but to care about the death of a machine is brilliant, and I thought they did that really well, and for personally, I thought, I saw the arc in each character, I thought, I was very sad with when Bodhi died. He was just, I had almost no feelings about him the whole movie until maybe like the last 20, 30 minutes or something like that of his scene. But I was really starting to like him, and then he died. But each died for their purpose, and I thought that was done brilliantly.
Hmm. Okay.
So for, I read Catalyst before I saw the movie, so I knew Jin's parents. Backstory. That helped me, one, to care more about them, who we only see like right at the beginning, and then we see Galen a little bit later. I actually felt that Jin's mother's character in the movie was not quite as in sync with the book. But as far as the other characters in the movie, I think I liked more the promise of what they were. Like, I agree that, like, maybe there's not the most character development in this movie, and it's an ensemble film, and I kind of think of it the way other people must feel about watching Serenity but not having seen Firefly. You know, like, there's all these people, and you don't necessarily understand all of the ways that they're interacting together, but, you know, you just kind of go with it.
I've seen all of Firefly, but not Serenity, so...
I didn't get any spoilers there. Just as far as... Because going into Serenity, if you haven't seen Firefly, you don't know how they interact with each other. Mm-hmm. And I got a bit of what I think that must feel like here in Rogue One. But I do think with characters like Chirrut and Maze and Bodhi, like, you get the idea that... But I don't know. I guess I got the idea that there's more to them, despite the fact that we don't understand all of their story now. And I guess I sort of also have faith in Lucasfilm and Disney and The Force or whatever, that we will get those backstories at some point. So I'm kind of waiting for that. Like, I would love to see a backstory of Chirrut, and I would really love, and I know there's been people calling for it, to see him meet, like, Kanan on Star Wars Rebels, who... during the course of the series has become blind and is learning to use the Force as a blind person. And so there's some nice little parallels there that would be really interesting to see those two characters acting together. But That for me, I guess, that idea of the promise of the characters more than maybe the actual development that we see in the story is what I sort of latched on to.
Yeah. Mark loves your Firefly and Serenity example, and Tom is still suffering residual Serenity grief. So while we're on that theme, I think I'll do one more Rogue One question, then we need to come back to Fantastic Beasts. But Emily, you want to make a comment before I do that?
Well, I just wanted to come to K2's defense in terms of his character arc. I think he is on a journey. I think, you know, when we first meet him, he floors Jin, you know, absolutely floors her to the ground, taking absolutely none of her crap. And then, you know, when they're on Jeddah and Jin is trying to sort of take a leading role, which K2 seems to resent a little bit, you know, she tells him to wait on the ship and hands him her bag, which he promptly drops, you know, because he's not going to serve her. He is not that type of droid. He is not going to serve this girl. Who is this girl? He thinks she's a bad idea, you know. And so, and then, you know, but he joins the rogue group, you know, and he says Cassian's making him, but I don't think that's really the case, you know, and by the end, he's just absolutely bending over backward, doing gross things to other droids in order to serve these guys. And, you know, and he gives his life setting them up to do the task at hand. Not him, he's in a totally other part, but he sets them up to do the task. So I do actually think he has quite an arc, and which is crazy for a droid, you know, but only in Star Wars, I guess.
He served a really important purpose, I think, in the whole universe from an artistic point of view, which was, for me anyway, he redeemed the droids and the slightly comic characters, right? I mean, he did so much to redeem or to heal the wounds of Jar Jar Binks, right? And he did so. He was better than C-3PO, as I thought, as far as like a balance of humor without being just ridiculous and childish. So I thought he served an important role there. Okay, so one final question right now from me about Rogue One, and then we'll see where we go, which is relating to this film as a war movie, which I can't see right now who brought that up. Was that Neil, maybe? Is it a war movie? And then Mark sent me a comment ahead of time that we really need to discuss Cassian's speech, which I thought was one of the most important moments. And I had a concern about this film myself. For the first time in all the Star Wars movies, I didn't identify with the Rebels as much. And it was sometimes because of terminology or tactics or certain visuals. There were some moments in the film that I found very, very disturbing. The sniper with the robes and the turban up on the bridge in the sandy planet, the child that Jin rescues from the crossfire, and then the moment when all the bombs go off timed, synchronized along the beach. For the first time, I was like, oh, rebels. And I thought ISIS. And I thought, these aren't rebels, these are terrorists. And then we have Cassian's speech. Some of us, most of us, we've all done terrible things on behalf of the rebellion. Spies, saboteurs, assassins, everything I did for the rebellion. And every time I walked away from something I wanted to forget, I told myself it was for a cause I believed in, a cause that was worth it. Without that, we're lost. Everything we've done would have been for nothing. I couldn't face myself if I gave up now. None of us could have. So, what's going on here? What is this film doing about war and about rebellion and about terrorism?
Can I start? Yeah. So I think the film's actually strong at kind of showing the complexity of this. I mean, why don't we, you know, it's 1914. We'll just go and we'll just fight the Germans, or we'll just go fight the English or whatever. And it's 4 years of this inch by inch bloody battle. It's roguish, right? And then you've got World War II, and then throughout the century, we discover that actually America, the greatest civilization on Earth with the biggest firepower ever, can't win small skirmishes in the Middle East. And when you look at history again that way, actually, never has the West been able to win small skirmishes in the Middle East. Actually, it's always problematic. And so I think what the film does is actually show the inch by inch nature of these things in a really effective way. But it's also there's also the point that the kinds of rebels you get, you know, in one area are not the kinds that you get. So we got rebels, and then we have this outer circle of rebels of the rebels who are Yeah, and so, and that's one of the complexities of World War II is who do you cooperate with to win this war? And so I think there's that dynamic. So I think you actually have different levels of humanity in fighting the war, and then you also have the film showing the difficulties of war in general, so, or at least in our age.
Yeah, Erica, I thought the same thing. Erica says that is how terrorists see themselves. This is all about your perspective. To ISIS, we are the enemy, whatever is necessary to destroy us.
If the terrorists win, I mean, I don't know we can do this now in the age of media, but historically, if the terrorists win, they're what we call actually the next government, right, or the next leadership. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we'll see what happens. I mean, and my brother-in-law is a genius on this kind of stuff, and he actually hoped that 7, 8, 9 would have actually been the fall of the rebels morally, so they actually win and then they collapse as leaders. They become the new empire. So mm-hmm. He sort of predicted it and what happens a bit in Rogue One. But anyway, I think Curtis is chomping at the bit.
I have a little bit. So there's a few things. You mentioned the Middle East stuff too, but you know, it's very interesting, which I agree with everything you said there, but it's very interesting to think back to when George Lucas was writing A New Hope, because at that time in the 70s, you're talking not about Middle East, you're talking about Vietnam. And his ideas about, you know, the conflicts in Vietnam and the things going on there are very much what inspired at least some of the earlier drafts, and then, you know, obviously we know how that all worked itself out. But I feel like one of the things that I like about Rogue One is that it does get into that grittier, more realistic idea of what a rebellion might actually look like, and probably brings us closer to that original idea that Lucas even had about this sort of conflict. Of a rebellion. I also want to point out, so we are talking about two different sets of rebels, and you know, Saw Gerrera on the desert planet there, Jedha. There's actually a backstory there from the Clone Wars CGI series, where he started out, him and his sister were rebelling against the Separatist army on whatever planet there, and Obi-Wan and Anakin and Ahsoka Tano go to their planet, and they actually train them. So there's sort of a further thing going on here when you think about, like, even like now where, like, you know, you have the U.S. Oh, we're not participating. We're just like training or helping out. You know, we're helping so and so. You know, learn how to keep their own peace and that kind of thing. You know, and then that turns into this really extreme, you know, or whatever sort of thing, like happened with Bin Laden, you know, or other people who we've perhaps trained and have turned into sort of these fundamentalist, you know, really scary rebels, terrorists, whatever you call them. And so I think there's a really interesting pulling him into, which I believe he's the first character that they pulled from an animated show, you know, canonical show still, but animated show into one of the movies. And I find his story really interesting if you go back and sort of read through. And he appears in Catalyst and stuff as well. You know, just to sort of find out how he gets to that point of where he's okay with these way more extreme measures. But then you look at someone like Cassian, who's perfectly fine with blowing up one of the people who are ostensibly on his own team, right? Like one of the more extremist rebels, or shooting him down or whatever he does, and then like he falls and blows up more people to save Jin. But like he has no qualms about shooting one of his own guys, right? And that's, I don't know, that is disturbing. Like that's, you know, when he the first time I saw it, I couldn't tell if when he falls and like there's like a stall that blows up, I wasn't sure if there were more extremist rebels in that stall or if it was like just, you know, like the little girl, like, could have just been regular people who happened to be in that plaza or whatever. It happens so fast, you can't really see one way or the other.
Yeah. Oh, good points. Thank you, Curtis. Hans was saying something similar here. There are three elements to the rebellion. There's the alliance, the military, and extremists. And Hans goes into some more details there. But they're not all aligned. There are, Erica says, there's conflict amongst the various rebel groups. And Mark says, you're exactly right. It shows what a rebellion looks like. It's not excusing what the rebels did, just showing it through their eyes. So someone, was it, must have been Kat, in your introduction to Fantastic Beasts, pointed out that there were also some historical parallels there as well, with Grindelwald's rise in the 40s. Do you want to talk about that a little bit, Kat, to get us back into the Fantastic Beasts mode? And then I have a specific question about beasts.
Sure. I mean, I didn't really prepare anything, so I'll try to think of what else to say that I haven't said, but yeah, it kind of, if my memory serves, in Deathly Hallows mostly is where you get sort of the Grindelwald backstory as, you know, Harry delves into Dumbledore's history, and, he, you know, there's the biography of Dumbledore that's published that gives him all this information that, you know, he didn't have, and kind of similar to what you guys were saying, it sort of complicates the good guys in the story of, oh, suddenly fascism is in Dumbledore's background and is something that he flirted with, of this notion of when he and Grindelwald were young and sort of a bit full of themselves and a bit full of each other, got this notion that, you know, as the sort of, you know, superior, you know, race of beings with this magical ability, it's, we have this sort of, I don't know, magical person's burden to take care of the world. And, you know, that easily turns into, you know, ruling the world and ruling, you know, muggles. You know, their ideas get more and more sort of extreme and their behavior gets more and more dangerous until the point that, you know, Dumbledore at least gets a wake-up call to step back and rethink things. And Grindelwald continues along, you know, this path. And so I don't feel like we get a lot of details of the actual conflict. You know, there's some that, you know, you kind of mostly just get what's relevant to Harry's story. So, you know, things like the symbolism of the Deathly Hallows, you know, the stone and the wand and the cloak and kind of what that meant to that movement as this sort of symbol of, you know, they're all powerful status, you know, which for parallels, you know, nicely kind of parallels the swastika because it starts, you know, the triangle with the circle and the wand in the middle predates its connection to this sort of horrific movement. It has a sort of, you know, very intense symbolism for the magical people as something good, you know, as sort of the symbol of the story, and it becomes sort of corrupted and, you know, a symbol of the evil of that, you know, terrorist organization, really, which is sort of the evolution of the swastika, which is thousands of years old. But today, we can only look at it and see, you know, Hitler and the Nazis and everything. So that's kind of, I think, what she's playing with, although I guess it's more in the movies that are going to come out where we'll get the detail of, I guess, Grindelwald's actual story and his rise and fall from power and everything.
Yeah. We've got some people making comparisons to Gandalf and his temptation with the ring. Jacob points out that's why Dumbledore didn't want the minister's job, because it was too much power. And Tony says it reminds him of a quote from Batman versus Superman. That's how it begins. The rage, the feeling of powerlessness turns
rage.
Cruel. Yeah. Chris Swank is asking a question that, Kelly, I don't know if you want this one. She thought that the Magical Congress of the United States was not a very nice government. What did you think about the way the Magical Congress was depicted?
Shoot, I haven't done a lot of the Pottermore stuff, so I don't know the American government, the magical American government and all of that. It's a little bit beyond me because my interest level in it is not too high.
But I thought
it felt a little flat, although the feelings I did get from watching Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them is that it was sort of corrupted in a way, and I can't pinpoint any reason why, but it didn't feel, and of course the Ministry of Magic is corrupted easily in throughout the Harry Potter films, so this is not something new, and it's not surprising, and it is a different time, and it is a different way of thinking, for sure, in regards to muggles and witches and wizards and their relations and things like that. And I think that we see that coming directly from the government, and that is uncomfortable. And yeah, it kind of rubbed me the wrong way too. And I don't know if that's just because of those things or because my interest level in American wizardry is high. But yeah.
Yeah, Brenton.
Actually, with due respect to J.K. Rowling, I'm thrilled with what she does. There were times as a non-American that the movie felt like it was a non-American film, a non-American writer of an American film. And I don't know, and I'd be curious to hear how Americans feel about this. So what you get in the Ministry of Magic and the Harry Potter books, the corruption is individual, which creates then systematic results, right? So power, lack of courage, whatever the issues are, and then it moves out from there. What you get in the film is this culture. So the culture itself has created this, we're going to react to a bunch of problems that happen in between the magic world and the non-magic world. So we're going to react to them, so we're going to create these protection mechanisms that then create the need for a rebel like Grindelwald then to break those, because it's a problematic response. Whereas Newt, I almost called him Newt Gingrich, that's interesting, Newt Scamander, different perspective, I think. Newt's commander comes in, right, and he offers actually sort of a third way out of that piece. So the British character comes in and offers this other way to think about, and it's all defined by, you know, clause 73 of the International Statute of Wizardry. It's this weird legal kind of problem that the children watching the film are supposed to struggle through as many lawyers and the disciplines and all the secrecy issues. So you've got all these issues about animals and about culture and stuff, and so it's a different kind of a thing. I was a little anxious about as I speak as a Canadian into American culture, I always remind myself where my seat is, and I'm not sure that didn't get forgotten in the making of this film, is that these are non-Americans speaking into American culture and then representing it, because now we have a systemic problem which then feeds individuals.
Was there not the bolstering of many American stereotypes too? Were they not done in shallow ways?
I mean, extreme interpretations, lack of subtlety, lack of nuance, a black woman president in the 1920s, which I thought was half black, I guess, seedy prohibition era bars, New Salem witch hunters, and evangelical religious structures without the religion. I mean, it even starts at a bank, right? It's got everything. That's right. Harry Potter starts in a suburb, Harry Potter America. I mean, we're in Manhattan, right? This is, it's a magical city. Yeah.
Well,
so, And especially the bare bones and them, especially felt like a comment, you know, the kind of puritanical, like you said, you know, evangelical fundamentalist, but without any sort of the compassion or, you know, anything that you associate with, like, you know, they're not preaching religion, they're not in service to anybody, it's that kind of pure legalism, which definitely feels, whether there's truth in there, you know, I'm sure there is, but it definitely felt like the British comment on, you know, American culture, you know, in the past and now, I think.
Yeah. Carita asks that, thoughts about magical and non-magical folks not being allowed to marry and how it might compare to things like anti-miscegenation laws in the U.S. Erica has sent me a link to Dr. Sturgis's blistering critique of J.K. Rowling's attempt at American magic. So I'm going to send you all that link right now. And Emily, you wanted to comment on this point?
I did, and I would recommend Amy's. I think that's probably her... her article in Reason magazine was excellent, excellently done. And, you know, I was really torn watching Fantastic Beasts because, you know, like Brenton, I really loved the film. I was highly entertained by the film. And there were times with the American portrayal that I was like, hey, I resemble that remark, you know. and then there were other times where I was like, gosh, that's a little heavy-handed, you know. And... So I do think, you know, the more I think about the bare bones crew, and the more I think about what Rowling had to go through from some of the Christian right in this country with regard to her books. And I'll tell you that I myself, as somebody who has utilized Harry Potter in, you know, my work in ministry and in my teaching, I'll use anything. I mean, I use Rogue One. I wrote an essay about Rogue One and the Paschal Mystery today, you know, on Hogwarts Professor. So, I'll use anything, you know, if it's there, I'll use it, you know. So, but you know, I got hate mail. You know, I was in an argument with somebody on a blog last week, who the person was suggesting that a priest that they knew had to perform more exorcisms because of Harry Potter than not. And I'm like, what are you talking about? You know, I mean, it's so...
Special category of exorcism.
Yeah. Right, I know. I'm like, yeah. So you know, these people are out there and...
Obscurus or...
What's that?
I said, are you sure they're not just obscurus, but...
Yeah,
it's possible. It's possible.
Well, thank you for saying that, Kat, because I want us to narrow it a little bit more and get really, really specific with our critique of the Bare Bones and the Witch Hunt. But I have a question from someone on my blog it's part of this. So let's do this question first, and then anything else you want to do about the Puritanism. So David Dawes asked this question on my blog, what about the language of repression? So they're talking about repressing the gift. And he asks, is this Freudian? And if so, whose Freudianism? Does it matter as far as the film and the script, what had been written by Freud and translated and popularized? Are we supposed to assume that these characters had read Freud and were applying his theory? Or is it anachronistic? Or is it just kind of loosey-goosey psychoanalytic pop psychology? So what's going on with the repression of magic?
Does anyone remember, do they use the word repression in the movie?
No, keeping it
remember.
In. They don't
remember one way or the other.
The word? Kelly, you want to check the screenplay for us?
There you go.
Quick scan.
They say suppress, says Tony.
Suppress, okay.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I took it as all being a metaphor, right? I took it to be a metaphor for sexuality.
So did I.
Yeah.
A pretty heavy-handed one, too, is what I saw from the movie.
Yeah, Brenton, you're not so sure?
I don't know. Like, we might be doing the same thing that the writers did. You know what I mean? Like, we might be pop psychologizing the pop psychology. Like I suspect that actually the metaphor was for magic, right? I think actually I would go back to it.
Magic. It wasn't a metaphor.
So a double metaphor makes it literal. I would go back to kind of Emily's comment, and I think so. Someone who's lived within the United States but is not American, somebody who dialogues with that world in a professional way, I actually find America much more diverse. But then when you talk to people who experience it through pop culture or through media or through like a 2016 campaign that went forever, it's a different kind of experience. And so I think it's very much ingrained in what how America is perceived in the world. And so I think they would immediately just go to repression in general. And you can put in sexual. I don't think it's terribly sexual. A great mistake in the editors in the States was actually calling it Sorcerer's Stone instead of Philosopher's Stone. Philosopher's Stone would have been maybe a little put-offish for some, but it would have actually solved a big problem right from the beginning. And from that point, you've got this weird divergence where evangelical Christians are some of the biggest defenders of the Potter world and some of the biggest offenders against it. I think I would go with Emily. I vote Emily on that one. So.
Well, and if I can just, you know, so the metaphor for magic, I mean, you know, I think Brenton, I think you're right. I mean, I think it can be read as sexual, and I think that that's sure. even okay with the screenwriter and the film's producers, that it be read as sexual. But I think we have to remember what the overarching metaphor of magic is for Harry Potter, and I've always seen that as a sacramental metaphor in terms of, you know, magic is the ability to see the power and the presence of God in the world. And, you know, our modern problem I shouldn't say problem, and it's not a problem to a lot of people, but our modern situation of secularization, where religious viewpoints get repressed to the point where extremisms and fundamentalisms develop, I think, you have a really multi-layered metaphor there going on, where you can take it as the sexual metaphor sort of on the surface, but then if you dig deeper, it can be a metaphor for religious extremism because of repression of religious expression.
Is there a bit of a breakdown between primary world and secondary world here? And if so, is that a problem? So I'll be a bit more specific about what I mean. So when they talk about witch hunts, and there's a moment when Hermione laughs at the fact that they used to burn witches. Isn't that ridiculous? Ha ha. So for me, that seems to be a bit of a breakdown in the secondary world, that when it starts to cross over to the primary world, then I don't know where I am as far as what I'm supposed to believe about magic and good and evil and good witchcraft and bad witchcraft. So who wants to talk about that a bit?
But isn't the Harry Potter world actually not a secondary world, but actually an alternative history? Right?
Yes. Like,
yeah, so in that reading, what we see actually, and with the nonfiction additions to the Harry Potter world, is we just get a different European timeline. It's the timeline told from the non-victors.
It's more like John Strange and Mr. Norrell then.
That's right. So I think, yeah, so in that sense, I don't think there's a breakdown. I think there's a rereading of history.
So then were there any real witches involved in any of these witch hunts in the alternative history then? And is witchcraft ever bad? Is it a matter of like using the magic for good or for evil?
Well, they mention witches who would get caught, real witches, who then would do magic on their flames, so they would get happily tickled and have a good old time and pretend to die and then sneak away. That's in somewhere in the books, I forget where. So I think it is supposed to be, I mean, probably we're meant to understand that some innocent people were, book three, was it? I think, like, there are meant to be real innocent victims that were killed, as happened in our own world. But, a certain percentage of them may have been true witches, but any true witch would have escaped pretty easily. So I feel like that's the kind of impression that we're given, is it's a bit of a mix of both.
Okay, so then let me tie that together with what Emily was saying, which I really like, but I'm going to interrogate it for a minute, Emily. So historically then, Christians, especially of the more sacramental types, have been really upset about witchcraft. Like, that's not a good idea. Mm-hmm. So to say that we're using, let's see if I can get this right, to say that we're using something that Christianity forbids as our emblem for the sacramental, mm-hmm. is that problematic or is that cool?
It's brilliant, in my opinion, because Christianity has always been a very materialistic religion. Faith, being in the starting point of the person of Jesus Christ, being an incarnation of God, a sign of God in the material world, but more than a sign, someone who actually is God, So we're centrally concerned with stuff, and the more time progressed, the more we began to debate about the importance of stuff, Catholics and the more sacramental versions of Christianity today are more and more materialistic and we spend more time with our beads and we get up and we change our posture a lot during this. So it's a very materialistic faith. And so I think it's natural to have this kind of a comparison. And so, but I think it's brilliant because, yeah, you're right. I mean, these are superstitions that people feared in the Middle Ages and kind of actually performed kind of counter superstitions to try to ward themselves away from. So it's playing on that tension, and it really is turning some of the fears on their ear. I mean, she's setting this very Christian story in this setting that you could interpret as very New Agey and sort of anti-religion. And so I think in that sense, that's where the brilliance lies, is where she's put this little gem in the midst of someplace you wouldn't look for such a thing. People are always, some of my students would talk to me about Harry Potter, like, what are you talking about, Christianity? And then I'd start rattling off some stuff, and they'd be like, you just ruined it for me. Like, well, sorry, but so I think it's, for somebody like me who does ministry, it's a great tool in the toolbox because it is so unexpected.
Mm-hmm. Let me put this into another context, too. I've been studying modern magic, by which I mean like the Golden Dawn, you know, Yeats and Crowley and Weyant and those people. And it's interesting there because you have two different branches. You have the branch that that really saw itself as being a Christian magical society, that they were Christians, but they're also practicing astrology and Kabbalah and tarot, and they were fortune telling and so forth. And then you have the side that was doing the stuff that's traditionally forbidden by Christianity, like the seances and communicating with spirits and things like that. But to tie this back to some of our favorite authors here at Signum, there were members of the Inklings who were involved in these things, you know, who were in these magical societies and were practicing these things and then using them in very, very similar ways. I mean, Charles Williams uses the tarot cards in The Greater Trumps in a similar way. And didn't Sarah Brown recently give a talk about alchemy in Tolkien and how he's using alchemical symbolism? So this certainly can be done, and I like that you're saying that it's being done here in the Harry Potter universe as well, Emily.
Well, you've also got a different kind of magic too, right? Like the magics are not all equal either. Right. So I think like a traditional Christian reading of magic would be the use of control, right? So it'd be some sort of control for self-gain. And I think that's actually one of the tension questions you get in the whole Harry Potter world, which I think is cool because it's actually just a normal human question of control. So I also, J.K. Rowling also subverts the whole kind of Christian West. Like she makes Hogwarts just before the first university founding. And like she kind of does all these kind of things to kind of prep you. I looked up the line. It's and Newt says, young wizards and witches sometimes try to suppress the magic to avoid persecution during the still being hunted by Muggles stage. And so there's these kind of these layering in. So I think actually, I think the different kinds, like alchemy is really just kind of a pre-critical scientific perspective from one view, right? So I think they all end up being kind of different things, and I would hate to smush them too much as we line them up and look at them.
Tony made the point that magic in the Harry Potter universe seems more like science than like religion. Yeah. Well, I want to start moving us towards wrapping up. So audience members, send in your final questions, comments. We've done a really great job of addressing the questions that came to me throughout the week. We've pretty much gone through, I think, every topic you all wanted to cover. Are there any sort of big picture things about adaptation, about film franchises, any other sort of like big concept things you want to cover? While you're thinking of them, I'll read a comment Brianna just sent in. It's hard to also separate Twitter-era Rowling's post-Book 7 writing from Fantastic Beasts and her Pottermore writings that are less thought out and less researched. And they're kind of activist for current-day social issues, sometimes in conflict with the canon. So these are some good points you're making, Brianna, about like franchise and authenticity and canon.
So, to what extent does that make Rowling like George Lucas?
Mm-hmm.
As far as, you know, going back with these prequels that are maybe less well thought out or don't hold to what the fans, anyway, think is the true story of Star Wars or Potter or whatever.
Right.
Well, it makes you wonder, you know, because of at least the divisiveness of the Star Wars prequels, you know, and Lucas's involvement in that. And then it seems to me like the last two movies have been much more well-received, both from, like, a fan point of view and just as movies, just for, like, the pure, you know, non-fan general audience. They've been more successful, more well-received. It makes me wonder, like, to what extent should or need Rowling be involved directly in these continuing spin-off, you know, things. Now, The Cursed Child, she didn't write the play for, and that wasn't exactly well-received, so it's not like it's necessarily good or bad for her to be doing things, but it just makes me wonder, with her continuing to come back to the well and expand on Pottermore and expand with these screenplays, like, there's a part of me that's curious what things would be like if they were written by these other people, and maybe she was continuing to write other stories in other worlds.
Although that
she has control. he has a lot of control. Like, this is a far more controlled world than even Lucas's, right? Well, I mean, how could you control what has become of the Star Wars universe? But she's even the cursed child. She was looking over the shoulder as that came out, right? So we're not the.
And the worlds are going to go on after the death of their original creators, right?
Right, but and it's that control to me that feels the most restrictive of. Even more so in The Cursed Child, but for both that and Fantastic Beasts, I don't know that I am convinced that every Harry Potter world story needs to directly reference the same events, the same characters, the same story beats as what was in the original books, because it sort of seems to me like you have the opportunity to go off and see something set in that world, but from an entirely new perspective with entirely new concerns, and yet we get Grindelwald, who sort of, you know, Johnny Depp takes off his mask at the end, and it's Grindelwald, and it's sort of like, okay, so here's where we're going for the next five movies. On the one hand, I'm curious to see more detail about his story. On the other hand, are we giving up other opportunities in favor of something we already have sort of explored before?
Right. Bollywood Harry Potter, maybe?
On that note, I'm going to sort of wrap us up with a final comment. And I think that'll be good for tonight. I just want to make one final observation, which has to do with sort of the power of these enduring stories. And I think that with the original core of each of these, so the original core three Star Wars movies and the original core seven Harry Potter books, I'd say that a lot of their power rested in their youths of myth, that they were really mythic, and they struck us as if they had kind of come out of a culture and as if they had been sort of collectively created rather than coming specifically out of the mind of just one individual creator. That's more so with the three Star Wars, but they also just really tapped into archetypes, and that's why we can do so much with them. That's why they're so enduring. And some of the later iterations and some of the spin-offs haven't been as mythic and haven't necessarily succeeded in those archetypes as much. Maybe they've stepped over into more stereotype, but the core mythic power is there, and if future storytellers can continue to fulfill those great needs we have for storytelling, then I think they'll continue to be successful. All right, that's about as much time as I wanted to devote to this tonight, so I think we will wrap it up, but thank you very much to each of the five of you for being here. Thank you to all of our attendees for being here and being so involved with your great comments. Sorry I didn't get to absolutely everyone, but I read everyone, and thank you for all you were saying. Remember, if you would like to support this series, you can go to signumuniversity.org/fund/donate, and we hope to see you all at future events. Thank you, Casey. May the Force be with you, too. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Bye.
Good night.
I don't know if they're gone. Cat and
they're all still here.
It looked like you guys were drinking out of the same cup because you had it in the corner, and it looked when it was the other way, as you brought it to your mouth, it's white on the back end. It looks like you're reaching for the same cup and sharing it.
Passing it across the thing.
Yeah.
Passing
it across. No, but it's the other way. It's actually the other way.
Other way, right? Other way.
So, yeah.
Oh, see, she's over here for me. Wait.
Yeah.
I did it. Messed it up.
No, that was my favorite part.
Find a way to pass it among all six screens.
Yeah, that's right. It's a cool
that
trick.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, if I had Fantastic Beasts, I would have snatched it from Emily from the side here. If I could.
Right, that's really good. Other way, Emily.
Yeah, it's all back.
Oh,
right?
Sorry.
I think we're all in different spots for each other. Yeah.
We're gonna have. I'm gonna have to work this out.
Oh yeah, it probably comes up randomly, but.
Yeah. Yeah.
So just to me, you two are at the top over here, and it just looked like you were sharing. Did anybody else? Can I ask a question? I didn't want to be recorded. Did anybody else? I just found the characters of the middle four of the central four of Fantastic Beasts. I found them to be sort of gorgeous characters, like on screen. I was very much connected to those characters, and.
In Fantastic Beasts? No.
Yeah, I love those four characters. I love those four characters.
Aesthetically, or their characters themselves?
Yeah, I guess I mean, I like the Kowalski or whatever his name is, yeah. And Polanski. I can't remember any of them.
Okay. The girl.
I'm going to make Brenton an organizer so that I can.
You were underwhelmed, Kat?
I was. So, yeah.
Or the characters.
The whole film in general, but the characters. I have an Eddie Redmayne problem. I have yet to be impressed by him in any form at all.
that creepy incest film, he was awesome in that. I can't remember the name of Savage Grace. Yeah, he was.
I haven't seen that movie.
Don't watch them back to back.
I don't know what my problem is with him. I like him enough as a person when I see him sort of as himself. I don't know that I think he's that good an actor.
Are you friends with him? Like
when you see him at Starbucks?
No, like in an interview or something. Like, he's a likable person. I feel like he gets by on his kind of likability, and he's riding this wave of kind of, I don't know, he's along with the Cumberbatches and all of them of, you know, British guys with that, you know, of that age with that accent. I don't get it. And this didn't change my mind. So
no, I'm in on him. I'm in on whatever his name is, the baker.
The baker was pretty good.
The baker we had a fat man, and that wasn't what it was about, right? So I mean, it was a real kind of critical difference, right? I mean, there was, he got stuck in the case once, but you know, I would have too. And he's a baker. I don't know. He's going to die at 58. It's just the way things are, right? And I thought Queenie, I can't remember all the names. Not Tina, but the other one, Queenie.
Right.
I thought she was gorgeous, but not in the way that the book described as the most blonde, beautiful wizardess, witch
that's
ever.
Fleur de la Cour.
Yeah, she's not the daughter of a... But to me, she was her kind of the way that she endeared herself to the other characters. I found that intriguing. So
I didn't even know why her sister had to tell her to get dressed, though. I was like, are you on the spectrum? Like, what's going on?
That's right. And she knew they were coming theoretically.
Yeah.
No, I don't know. No, I'm the opposite on the characters. I love the characters. Those four. I don't know about the bad guy. So I don't know how I feel about what's his name? The Irish guy playing the bad guy.
Colin Farrell.
Yeah, I don't know about Colin Farrell.
It was kind of silly to have we have a famous actor playing the villain who takes off, you know, his Scooby-Doo mask, and it's an even more famous actor playing an even
I like Johnny Depp, so we'll see.
I know, I liked. I was excited to see Johnny Depp, but...
Yeah, like, I don't know if he's going to grow dreads and start piracy on the side, but I think, Johnny Depp's diversity of portfolio is one of the things that intrigues me to him, so to see a whole film, the next film being sort of about him and whether or not he plays him, whether we go back or forwards, I assume forwards. So, I don't know. Yeah. Still, to me, my favorite part was actually seeing the beasts that were in the books, kind of come up. But I'm still curious. The stuff from Star Wars is all fiction that supplements it, or mostly fiction that supplements. But the stuff that we have with the Harry Potter world is largely nonfiction that supplements it. That's a bit of a generational thing. Kids these days are just grabbing Marvel support stuff and DC support stuff. They're gobbling up these things. And so I was disappointed in Fantastic Beasts because it wasn't the bestiary that, you know, like Tony DeLaTurrizzi and Holly Black did with the Spiderwick Chronicles, which is a lovely kind of bestiary. And so I was always disappointed that in the result of Fantastic Beasts, I thought it could be a big, thick leather book that I'd pay $100 for, filled with sketches like a guidebook, and it wasn't. And so I was sort of sad. It was also like $4 used on Amazon. But So I hope that then they can take and they can even do that drawing version of the screen shots and redo the book kind of based on that. I would like that as a beast here.
Well, that's kind of what I mean by missed opportunities. Like, not that it had to be this, but I think I would have been more interested in, like, an actual story of, you know, a story about magic zoology, for example. Like, rather than, we're going back to the Grindelwald well, like, of, like, okay, there's beasts in the background, but they're really kind of on the periphery of the story. And to me, it's like, well, Newt in the wilds, some story about him sort of hunting for these beasts. Not that it would just be that, like, there would be a story to it, but that would have been, like, an expansion in a way that... It's interesting you brought up Marvel, because I'm not a big Marvel fan either. And this feels like it's that thing where everything just has to fit, and we have to make everything, all the puzzle pieces, fit and work. And it just feels less imaginative than I would kind of...
You and I are in opposite worlds, Kat, here. So.
Well, bringing us back to the question about control of the universe, and I think it's really interesting, and Curtis and Kelly, correct me if I'm wrong here, but I feel like the picture that we got about Star Wars and the making of all those Star Wars, the first six Star Wars films, both from the Chris Taylor book and also from Amy in class, was that, you know, it was like the more Lucas was sort of willing to collaborate, you know, the better the films turned out. So, like, the original three, he was still so new that he had to collaborate, but in the prequels that he was so concerned with control over those, and they suffered as a result. And that's why I've been so excited about the newest Star Wars offerings, is because they feel like this great collaborative effort. They don't feel like it's tokenism, you know, when they have a character of different, you know, characters of different ethnicities. It feels very natural, it feels very real. And I worry about beasts because of the control issue.
Yeah, I agree with that. The thing that actually always comes up in my mind when I think about that and the different level of control that Lucas, or I mean anyone really, is you know, the Tolkien letter to Milton Waldman, where he says his own legendarium should be linked to a majestic whole but leave scope for other minds and hands. And it's that ability of other people to come in and add their own bits to it. And not that necessarily the auteur or whoever, you know, like George Lucas, has bad ideas, but he was also, from the very get-go, he was also a terrible scriptwriter and storyteller. Like, when you look at those histories, like, you see, like, there were a lot of people sort of behind the scenes cleaning up his dialogue and sort of giving him advice, like Francis Ford Coppola, you know, a little guy like that, you know, sort of, you know, saying, well, what about this? So I agree with you. Like, the more that he sort of controlled things, and not just that he controlled it, but as I think Brenton, you alluded to earlier, like, you know, by the time the prequels come around, you know, that's a genie you can't stuff back in the bottle, right? Because you've already had this expanded universe that's been going on for over a decade at that point, you know, with comics and novels and I mean, even the Star Wars Christmas special and that kind of stuff that have just opened so many different doors, that for him to just say, no, now I'm going to take control of it all back, is just ridiculous.
The Star Wars fans are the Tolkien super legalists of the earlier generation, right? So you see this, like, you just can't get away with certain things in the Star Wars world, right? So even if you wanted to play with it, I think you're limited just by the fan base.
And I'll be honest, I mean...
In a good way, maybe.
I've struggled with the prequels. I mean, I'll accept them because, like, they're not going away, unfortunately. Like, they're still going to be there. And so I've tried to, like, come to grips with it. But even, like, so there was an article passed around recently about... there was a discussion in the Eagle and Dragon Forum around the whole state of healthcare in the prequels and why Padme, you know, like, never saw an OBGYN during her pregnancy. And, I was reading it, and I'm like, these are all really good points. But at the same time, there's, like, that knee-jerk reaction to defend the Star Wars work. And I'm like, really? I'm like, I'm trying to defend the prequels. Like, there's never been anything else where I've wanted to defend the prequels before. Why is this, like, an instinct in me? And I ended up not commenting on the post because I didn't know how to resolve my own conflict in my mind about it. But I don't know. I kind of rambled there. But
I feel like I've been thinking about canon a lot lately, trying to figure out like why these certain things piss me off and other things don't. And like, I don't know, like for the legalistic Tolkien fans, like I love the canon wank stuff. Like I just finished my reread of Lord of the Rings. I'm into the appendices. It's great. Like lists of names, I'm like all there. But like he was not legal. He was not legalistic. He constantly rewrote his stuff. And we think of it as legalistic because we have a printed final version, but like that's why you have the history of Middle Earth, is to say that in 1915 it was one thing, and in 1937 it was something else. And it was one thing when it was published in 1955, and by 1970 it was something different. And he was constantly evolving, but he never just said, like what they did with some of the Star Wars spinoff, where they said, okay, this doesn't count anymore. So all these beloved books that you grew up reading, they now have no meaning, and because we say so. Like, he would find a way to include it and have, okay, it's all true, it's just, well, it depends on which record you're reading, or it was elvish bias, or it was like, you know, Bilbo told two different versions of a story, and they're both true in the world. Yeah, exactly. Like, one was the fudged, this makes me look good version, and one was the true version of what really happened, and he found a way to redo it without kind of saying, okay, this is now non-canon. Like, I don't think he thought of canon the way we do, where you have this list of, like, rules that you have to sort of, you know.
Well, see, I was accused of being immoral for saying that. Like, we did a blog series, right, Kat, on the Last Hobbit movie, and there was a few different bloggers, and I did mine on living text and how Tolkien kind of moved his text forward. It was always alive, and actually, whether we like it or not, actually, we're contributing to the text, and so are the filmmakers, and so are the fans, and so are, in the Tolkien world, of course, there's a whole bunch of Lord of the Rings-esque material that's not as good, or not quite as good, or maybe some as good on its own merits, and so that's living text. I was called immoral, right, for not saying
immoral.
That the films were all bad. Immoral, like, literally, it's on my blog. I was called, like, you cannot be a good human being, you know, for not just trashing everything that Peter Jackson did, right? And I wonder, and of course Star Wars, when I said that the world was getting smaller, I also meant that the fan base kind of narrows down possibilities. As the possibilities explode, there's still this kind of narrowing. And maybe that's actually sort of the organic way that canon develops. Like, canon is never... Like, canon, if we talk about biblical canon or something like that, it's actually something that emerges out of a community, mm-hmm. and then is shaped by all these different forces and factors, right? And so that's actually a pretty good description of what happens in the Star Wars world. It's not a good description of what's happened in the Harry Potter world.
Right.
In the Harry Potter world, it's a very much controlled thing. And there will be other stuff. Like, I would pick up 7 more Harry Potter books today if they were written by J.K. Rowling and there was something different.
I'm interested in it all, even if I don't like it all equally. Like,
yeah,
you know, like, well, this, like you begrudgingly assume you know.
Yeah.
If I could go back and not read that,
you would read it.
She didn't write this, and made me mad because you could tell she didn't write it.
Right.
It was indulgent fan fiction. And it wasn't even good. And I write fan fiction. I love fan. You know, it wasn't good.
The thing is, it was indulgent. Period. I don't care if it's fan fiction or not. There's great. Like, I think Rogue One and all these things we're talking about are fanfic in that sense of it's later people, not even the creator, expanding the world in new ways.
Force Awakens,
and some of it sucks.
Right, Force Awakens, like, I think one of the weaknesses of that film was the giving back over to nostalgia and fan. I thought Rogue One had kind of cleansed itself of something, like, it got it out of the system in the Force Awakens, so there was a lot more freedom.
Sure.
Like killing off all the characters.
Yeah, they were like icing on the cake in Rogue One, whereas the nostalgia was built into the plot in Force Awakens, and I think that's why you had a lot of backlash from some fans. I loved it, but you had a lot of backlash saying...
Yeah.
Yeah, this is just recycled, A New Hope, and blah, 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 whereas Rogue One people, you know, my best friend and my husband both got up out of the theater and said, I like that better than The Force Awakens. Mm-hmm. And I don't agree, I like them both, but I think that's what that's what people are trying to express, is that you don't want the plot recycled. You want to see that one guy from the bar on Tatooine, that's pretty funny, but you don't want the plot recycled.
To me, fan fiction is a neutral term. You know, it's not, it says nothing of quality to me. Like, it's the impulse to retell a story from a different angle or new perspective or expand it or whatever. And sometimes that results in a cursed child. Sometimes that results in a Rogue One. Sometimes, for me, like, all of Arthurian literature is fan fiction.
Like, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Like, it says, and it can be good
including
or bad.
Including the originals.
Sure. Yeah.
Right. Like the ones, all the ones we have are fan.
Are based on something. None of those
are. I mean, people were doing this. I mean, I think it was even Perry in one of his classes that said, you know, in the Middle Ages, if you rewrote one of the great works of literature, that was amazing. If you came up with something original, who cares?
That's
that was the mentality, and that's really why we.
Why would you want to be original? Like, I don't. I don't understand. It doesn't make any sense. There's no reference points. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like telling a joke part way in, right? And storytelling has that oral kind of feature that we've narrowed it down. We've lost it. I think film can help us recover orality, but we've the textual reality of these things kind of means that we have this originalness that has to come out of these moments. But kids will reread and rewatch the same thing over and over again. Like, it's just it's liturgical. It's ritualistic the way that they'll read these things. And I wondered the weight of the world too, I think, affects. So I think today, if we had the right people, they could insert good things into the Middle Earth world that were representative and filled that out. But I don't know if Narnia needs anything. Do you know what I mean? Like, I think it's better to leave that open. I think anybody who wrote Narnia film or books today would just end up writing something that wasn't as good.
Maybe certain things are more suited to that than others.
Maybe, yeah. Well, but there's a weight to the world. Narnia doesn't want weight to it, right?
Mm-hmm.
But even to that point, like, there's still stories like Bridge to Terabithia, which relies heavily on the Narnia story to tell its own completely different story.
Right.
Yeah, and they did it. No, that's great. And When You Reach Me by, what's her name? She wrote Lyra and the Spy, Patterson, or no, anyway, there's this book, When You Reach Me, that loops Madeleine L'Engle's Wrinkle in Time all throughout. And actually, she actually accepts one part of. Oh yeah, it's When You Reach Me by Rebecca Stead. Yeah, actually, on my blog, if you go into my blog and you search for Rebecca Stead, you'll find it. And I actually talk about that intertextuality. It's not. I called it "Is It a New Kind?" And of course, if I had waited a week, I wouldn't have written that. But she actually accepts a part of the worldview of the Madeleine L'Engle A Wrinkle in Time piece, but it's completely different kind of setting, and I thought it was elegantly done, and of course that happened a lot more in the past, and that's when Sørina talked about the double clicking on the other universe. She's referring to a paper I wrote where I said that what C.S. Lewis does, he's very much that intertextual guy where he draws in all these other worlds, and when he puts an image or a word up, you double click it and you get the whole world behind that, whether it's Arthurian or Charles Williams or Tolkien before he finished it, right? And you click on it and then you get the world behind it, and that's what she's referring to. And I think that Rebecca Stead did that really well in that little book. It's just a 2-hour read, hour and a half read, quick book.
Nice. I never heard of that before.
Yeah, my old coworker, who's a children's book specialist up in San Francisco, loved that book, and I couldn't place it. But as soon as he said Rebecca Stead, yeah, it's supposed to be really, really good.
Yeah, it's a fun book. Yeah.
That what you were just saying about the clicking into hyperlinks of other things—that's kind of the premise of John Granger's book, Harry Potter's Bookshelf. Harry Potter does. It's like it. Oh, okay, cool. It because through the references and the borrowings from other types of literature, you could use that as a gateway to, you know, Jane Austen and schoolboy novels and gothic literature, whatever, and it kind of opens up the library for you.
Yeah. The book I haven't written is that I actually think that C.S. Lewis is actually like, he pictures authors like a round table, like Arthurian round table, and the way that they contribute, you know, in that world, the way that they share and the way that they're gentlemen and knights together and all those sorts of things, including the occasional Queen Guinevere, the way that they interact and then the way that the medievals would build a cathedral or build a book or a story or build, you know, a community, that's actually how Lewis wants to write, and that's how he views other authors. So when he looks like he's ripping off or drawing in, he actually views himself in fellowship with these others. And so I just finished transcribing Lewis's first novel attempt when he was 17 years old. He wrote a Arthurian tale called Quest of Bleris. It's about maybe a third or a half done, I don't know. And he abandoned it because he was bored. And he says in there, he's writing epistolary to Galahad, which is what he called his best friend, Arthur Greaves. And he actually writes in there, if, you know, our friend Jane Austen would be able to describe this character, I just simply can't. And he kind of moves on, and so even at 17, I had this instinct to kind of draw these other people into his own kind of imaginary fellowship, and so they all become part of his literary project. He just died before they all got out, I think. But yeah, so that's kind of this.
On social media.
Can you say that again?
Can you imagine him on social media? He'd been crazy. Oh. He'd be crazy.
He
might lock himself in a room. Yeah, that's right. Well, see, I don't know if he could do it, because you can't be the same kind of reader. Like, none of us, if we engage in social media, could be the kind of reader that he was, where he would sit for, you know, 10 hours, and there was no reading that was good for him unless it was an hour long, right? And whereas we skim screens, right? And we grab things. We can all sit for hours and read, but we grab things. And I don't know if he could do it. Just the quickness of the movie. So you look at Rogue One and 40 years before, you know, New Hope or Star Wars, what I call it. Like the quickness. Like I don't know if someone in 77 couldn't watch the film that we just watched.
Mm-hmm. That was what I was thinking is when watching them, like, in order and stuff, it's like I can't see like someone going from Rogue One or even Force Awakens or whatever, watching a modern film and then slowing down enough and appreciating the older films. It doesn't work. It doesn't work for me. I don't know.
Yeah. I felt that way more for Force Awakens. Like, that was one of my criticisms in my review of it, was that it felt like you snapped your fingers and you were across the galaxy, right? Like, especially when you think about in A New Hope, like, how long are they on the Millennium Falcon while it's in hyperspace? Like,
well, they play chess.
They play chess, and Luke does his training.
He's learned how to be a Jedi.
You know, like, that's right. Literally all of his Jedi training happens in hyperspace in the middle of the movie.
Like, in that moment. It's a great moment.
And like, I get that there's different sort of sensibilities and the need, well, maybe not need, but the expectation of, you know, like, cutting from thing to thing. But I do think, I noticed it more in Force Awakens, but I understand, like, the criticism or comment, like we had earlier, where it was like, you get five planets in 5 minutes, and you're expected to sort of remember all of these things and know how they all fit in and all that.
I watched it
three times.
I watched it. I actually downloaded a pirated, like, someone with a camera, right, one of those versions, so that I could rewatch for this, just because I just needed to, because it was 2 months ago or whatever, right, that I saw it, and so there, or a month and a half ago, so it was, I mean, that was a tough thing. One of the things, though, like, I love about the potential of the Star Wars world is this. So, like, with Chirrut or Chirrut or whatever his name is, the Ip Man, when he dies, right? Like, he's like the death of the Jedi in a sense, but he's also not the complete Jedi, right? There's just there's all these things, and I love seeing now in my mind. I can replace the movies. I can actually see the degradation of technology through the series. right? So it gets worse and worse and worse and worse, the sheer technology. That's why you don't have an OBGYN. And then, but at the same time, we've got to reconcile with the filmmaking kind of going like this, right, as far as, you know, like sophistication.
Right, of the effects and everything. Yeah.
That's right, the effects. And yet there were some zippers on the back of the Rogue One film, and there were some awkward lines, like in some ways... Like it was good that way. I kind of enjoyed that it wasn't perfect in some ways, too. So,
right.
To me, it wasn't quite as tight as Force Awakens, which I kind of liked. I like the zippers on the backs, actually. I like the Ewoks and where you see, like, a jean pant leg or something like that. These things are cool. Cool for me. I don't know. I wonder, if Anakin had been cast differently, would we just be disappointed with the first three movies, the adult Anakin? If he wasn't such a whining snot, would we have felt...
I feel like one of the big... And this is as a non-Star Wars, like, fan person, so this is, like, an outsider's perspective. But, like, to me, for these most recent two movies, I feel like good casting goes a long way.
Oh, towards, I love Rey.
Covering a multitude of sins in, you know, in script or in thin characterization. Like, if you have a really good, and they've gotten, like, these are good character actors that they're hiring. And you don't need a giant, big backstory when you have someone like Oscar Isaac, who can, like, kind of, like, show you, or any of them, any of these new ones and stuff. So, maybe casting is, like, part of the flaw of the prequels.
I think that's a whole problem,
but...
Well, Anakin was painful.
I think the problem was Anakin.
You know what? Anakin is a whining snot. I mean, that is...
Yeah.
Especially in my headcanon, Anakin is just a difficult young man. And I feel like Hayden Christensen did a pretty good job with it. I had a huge problem with Natalie Portman, especially in the first film. I was like, oh my gosh, we don't have time for this captain. Why did she talk like that? Who told her to talk like that? So, yeah, my problem was more with her. And, I mean, I just think, you know, Jar Jar Binks was just such a blot on that first film. And you know, it's like this big popular thing to get all sentimental and get all appreciative of Jar Jar Binks these days and, like, stop the Jar Jar hating, stop the Jar Jar, you know, and I appreciate that, and it's okay to like him.
Where is that, the attitude towards him?
I listened to the podcast, Full of Sith, and they have a Facebook page, and everything. It's like a kind of a really nice community, and, like, one of the things that they try to do is be welcoming to all types of fans and not try to pull this, you're not a real fan if you like the prequels, or you're not a real fan if you don't like the prequels, or whatever. So I appreciate that, but there's a lot of people who are, like, doing this Jar Jar thing where they're like, oh, you know, Jar Jar is actually the key to everything because, you know, Qui-Gon encourages Obi-Wan to accept him. He's this kind of lesser fool character, and yet he becomes this key component to winning the war on Naboo and everything. I agree with that in the short term, but, like, they're like, actually, he's the key to the whole series because when Yoda meets Luke on Dagobah, he acts like Jar Jar to try to test Luke to accept this foolish character. I'm like, you are confusing him with Dobby the House Elf, okay?
Yeah.
He is not Dobby the House Elf. Dobby the House Elf actually had a character arc, you know, that ended heroically, but Jar Jar did not, no matter what they did with him in the Clone Wars.
Sadly, actually.
I was just going to say, the goofiness of Yoda, though, is actually more... It's like either a second or third draft of A New Hope, which it wasn't called A New Hope, of course, it was the Adventures of Luke Starkiller at that point. Where Obi-Wan Kenobi is that more of that impish, and there's actually dialogue. I tweeted it out from the Mythgard Twitter account. There's actually dialogue that Lucas stole right out of Tolkien. It's the good morning passage from the Hobbit where you have Luke and Ben doing the whole good morning bit, obviously it was changed, but, you know, then Kenobi goes off and is, like, giggling, like, Yoda-like off to the side, anyway, it's just kind of a funny little anecdote, but
Lupin wants to talk, Kelly. Just let him talk. He wants to tell us about Jar Jar.
He's telling me it's dinner time.
While there's a momentary lull, I shared with you guys, I couldn't share with, I don't know if we actually still have people listening, or like, we just talking to ourselves, or...
They can still see us.
Okay.
Can
they hear us?
They can see us.
29 people are still here.
I shared with you guys, anyway, because I can't share with everyone, apparently, the link to Kat and I's 100th episode of our podcast, where we talk a lot about canon, and you can get her full feelings on the Marvel... on the MCU.
I was going to bring this up earlier, because in that, probably in the show notes, I linked to, like, in my Doctor Who research, this thing I found, like, my favorite, clarified for me how I feel about canon, and it's a long blog post, which you probably only really care about if you like Doctor Who, but basically about why canon is stupid and evil.
Well,
and
they're still watching. Sorry, I'm sorry. Chris Swank just answered your question. They're still watching. Can you guys hear? Oh,
hey guys.
My goodness.
I can't see anything. I can't see what people are typing, though. But
no,
I got it. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, I don't think there's a Brenton.
Brenton is the organizer now, so I think
I'm the organizer now. So.
Do you have power over
this whole situation? Yeah, we're still here. We're still watching. Kat is a canon hater, says Neil. And people are starting to leave here, but they commented about the Clone Wars animated series, about how J.R. Tolkien wrote, like, the niggle stuff. Like, all of this was here.
That's great. Well done, folks.
Great comments. Yeah, we did it. Great comments.
Yeah, Casey says hello, Brenton. Hello, Casey. So, I'm sorry, I really interrupted somebody speaking there, but it was just all of a sudden I have all this material here.
All this attention.
Kat, you were hating on canon.
Right. Oh, I was hating on canon. Anyway, it's a very long and, I think, for me, clarifying post about the aspects of canon, which can be destructive to creativity and community rather than helpful of it, so...
Is this a blog post of yours?
Not mine. No, I think I referenced it in our discussion. It's by another blogger. It's called like Canon and Sheep Shit, something like that. And
in a sheep shed, like as in meditation.
No, sheep shit. Sheep shit.
Oh, okay.
One more time.
Let's get just emphasize.
What?
Another thing you were saying about this reminded me when you're talking about the difference between the casting is I thought of the difference between the effects, and to me, for the more recent Star Wars movies, like the rediscovery, not just in Star Wars, but in like lots of other movies of like practical effects of like just because we have a green screen doesn't mean we have to use it all the time. And I just feel like that one thing in The Force Awakens of Rey pouring the water on her bread and it like expanding in front of her was like better than 3 prequel movies of like CG everything. Yeah. Like, you know, like just that notion of you can go back to things that have real weight and, you know, and you use the CG around it to create the world, but you have real light that bounces off of like objects, and it just gives things a different feel, I think.
I think that horrible apocalyptic film 2012 was the tipping point in CGI, and whether filmmakers have figured it out or not, there's a recovery of the textural, right? To use embodiment, to use Emily's phrase, right? There's this desire to kind of come back and to touch, and I was a little disappointed with the last 3 Hobbit films, because they actually moved us away from trees and dirt, and like I couldn't smell the films, right? Which I can't, by the way. That's not a special gift, but like I can fill that part in. I don't want a 4D experience. I want I don't know what the fourth D is, but I assume it's smell, or maybe it's tickling chairs. I don't know what it is, but
Legolas going like that on the falling bricks.
Oh, well, is that
and
right?
Something like they didn't use real miniatures. You know, they went to models.
Where's the bigatures?
Right, exactly. Makes a difference. Like whether or not you realize it, it makes a difference in how you perceive the movie.
They didn't use real people. Like Dane is. Completely, like CGI. Like, why would they CGI a dwarf?
Speaking of which, what did you all think of the CG people in Rogue One? We didn't talk about that at all.
Yeah.
Digital Cushing. It was tough for me to focus on what he was actually saying.
Yeah, I just ignored him.
Which is frustrating. For me, so Tarkin as a character. I mean, obviously, from Star Wars, you know, he's a big part there as, like, the guy in, you know, charge of the Death Star and all that. And he has a big role in Catalyst as well, you know, the prologue to Rogue One. So it was really hard for me to focus on just what he was even saying and doing as I kept thinking, like, man, I wish they had just, like, pulled away and, like, made things a little fuzzier and, like, not had, like, that close-up of him, like, so long.
I would have been happy with a recast. Honestly, I felt a little weird about it from an ethical standpoint.
Me too.
Like,
I had the exact same thought.
Followed so closely by then Carrie Fisher's unfortunate passing.
Sure. I don't know if they knew that would happen.
No, I'm sure they didn't, but at the same time...
No, but it does
kind of a surprise.
What kind of a can of worms does this open, you know?
Exactly. I mean, I felt bad for his family. I mean, I don't know, maybe they loved it. Maybe they thought maybe enough time
to... I would imagine they would have had to have some kind of legal...
Estate was thanked in the credits.
Yeah.
Well, they're all looped in too, right? So in Gladiator, I can't remember who the mentor character's name was, but he died during the filming, and that was kind of the first CGI character that I know that was meant to match in that sort of way, and so that's fine. But if the Dumbledore actor had died, and they did that for the movies 3 to 7. Like, right. So I think there's places, Neil here on the comments said that Leia was so quick and it was just, he liked the connection. I have to say that one was better certainly than the other one.
Extended
so
sequences of it.
That's right. But I have to, I'd have to say I would love for someone just to walk a dog in a film. Like, I want to see if footprints match up, or like the footfalls match up with the feet. You know, I don't know. I'm yearning for some connection. I would like that's one of the things about the original. Like when we land on one of these worlds, we stayed a while out of space, right? And I think they've forgotten in the Star Wars movies, the big movies, that actually it's not space that we love, right? It's not blackness with stars that are just kind of in the background. There's something else. And it's not travel that we love. And is it war that we love? Like, are Star Wars disappearing into the action kind of world? I don't know. So they have to discover what we love, I think. And for me, I want more text-based movies, right? And I don't watch a lot of realistic fiction, but I watched Sing Street the other night with my wife, and we just did a indie Irish movie night, and it was great. It was just dumb kids and playing instruments with moderate skill, and that was great for me. Sort of a relief after all the Marvel films and stuff, you know?
Right.
Yeah. Which, my kid is a super fan, and so I will end up seeing them all, plus all the background stuff, and I'll have all the coffee book table material. I just can't do anything about it, and I like aspects of it, but I want something connected for me. So apparently 4D is sense around. So Neil says 4D, and Karita says that a tickling chair, her husband says, is that I don't think tickling chair is that genre of film. So apparently it's not a tickling chair. But
you can get those at the salon, though, when you get your feet done. You can have
okay, that's right. That's right. And maybe put a... I was going to say put a toonie in, but you don't have toonies. Put a coin in into the chair, right, and make it operate it.
No, it's they're with the price of the pedicure. So yeah.
Yeah. Somebody, there's a question for you, Kurt, from Hans Joseph. I want to ask how Rogue One plus the original trilogy line up with the history of the IRA.
I don't know the history of the IRA well enough to talk about that.
They were the terrorists of the age. Like, so the movies start, sure. And the terrorism is much more local than it had been. So maybe there's sort of a connection there. But somebody should write a blog post on that out there.
Yeah,
of all these people who we didn't know were watching, you know.
It's very possible that it lines up very well. I just don't know enough about the IRA. Sorry.
Yeah. People making Star Wars now are big history people, which is great. I mean, I see a lot of that coming through in the storytelling going forward, and I really appreciate that.
Yeah.
About Star Wars. I don't know.
Yeah, it's that mythic connection. I think Sørina was right in that. And that's why Joseph Campbell loved at least the original Star Wars work. Thinking about it, he was able to think about it critically from his archetypal kind of standpoint. So,
right,
what do you mean? Is Joseph Campbell?
Well, because, you know, well, no, I mean, because Lucas kind of utilized Campbell in his storytelling.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. There's a loop there, right?
Yeah, right.
It's very Slavoj Žižek kind of a moment in history there. So
Did he on purpose or no? I know he sometimes said he did, and sometimes said that it was, you know, his own thinking. Of course, he's
according to How Star Wars Conquered the Universe, he read it as he was writing between one of the drafts that he wrote. I don't remember which draft specifically. He also read like The Golden Bough. And like a bunch of different fairy tales and that sort of thing. So he was immersing himself a lot in sort of the fairy tale and then into Joseph Campbell's work about fairy tales and all of that stuff at the time that he was writing it.
Yeah. I don't think we've done a Golden Ballot. Save your method.
No.
Not that I'm aware of. No,
we have not.
And have we done a Joseph Campbell? I don't know.
He, he's been mentioned, obviously, but not as like a study itself.
Here are a thousand faces.
I keep pushing for an alchemy course too.
Like a how-to.
And like, well, no. but like, I think like, or like magic. You know, some kind of survey of magic in you know Western literature.
This should be Sørina's next project. Is create the kind of magic and the cult. Class for Signum of like the history
and
everything.
She does really scary stuff. The Book of English Magic. That's lovely. Yeah. Well, I actually suggested a course basically called Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. But apparently they're legal problems with that. Just to do a class on bestiaries and then to do a class also with a class on fantasy maps, right? So we actually spend time on both those. Because I mean you could certainly spend 12 weeks on either. But to spend some time in some great bestiaries and to spend some time on some of the great fantasy maps might make kind of a cool kind of collaborative class. And that's one of the things that's missing. So in Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, we get the beasts, but we don't get the maps. He keeps referring to these places, and we don't get to go to them. We get sort of Arizona backyard in the suitcase. We get this sort of little zoo in then Arizona, right? Which is cool. I've not been to Arizona. Where I wanted to see Egypt and Africa and Eastern Europe and like the Ridgeback dragon habitat and all that. We'll get there?
I think in each movie it's based somewhere else. In Paris, I think, specifically. And what I think will happen is that Newt's adventures will take him across the world because that's what they do. And then at the same time, each time he goes to a different place, he'll be seeing a different rise, a different group, a different type of people invested in what Grindelwald's doing. That's how I envision them kind of wrapping it up, like kind of tying it together.
Populism.
We'll get more stereotypes about other cultures.
Right.
Yeah.
Let's do the polls now, right? Yeah.
So we're gonna watch populism rise on the screen as it rises in, you know, the world.
In real time.
I have to say I'm super glad the film wasn't made in early 2017, set with this political background to what happened in the United States. I'm glad that kind of the script was set, you know, 9 months ago, and so now you can suffer and enjoy your current political regime without Joanne Ruling's visual commentary. You can still follow her Twitter feed, right? And so I'm kind of glad. It's just Brexit and that, like this, I mean, Canada has the last liberal leader in the world, right? And so and he's like a drama coach that happened to get the job. So you've got these political moments, and those aren't the things. So yeah, there's all kinds of concerns about how she defines America or how we live with America as non-Americans, but at least they're not Brexit, and at least they're not Donald Trump, right? Or if it had been the other thing, whatever Hillary would have won. So at least it's not that. That's sealed in. That's momentary. But these other cultural questions, I think, will go. I think that they should do, like, Anna Green Gables, like, in the third Fantastic Beasts series reboot. I think that would be a good time to loop in Anna Green Gables here in Prince Edward Island.
They go to Prince Edward Island and find some fantastic.
Yeah, we've got it. Well, we have our own fairy culture, right? So there's the whole kind of some of the fairies that immigrated with in Prince Edward Island in a different kind of way. So, yeah. So I don't know if that will work or not. I doubt it. They never come here.
I don't know.
That's right. Fanfare. I'll make my own CGI film. You know, it's gonna have a lot of toilet paper tubes and stuff, though. So yeah. Well, I'm at 10:20 my time. I think I'm gonna slip out. There's a suggestion of the course instead of getting sued, the store's course could be called Mythical Cartography and the Beast Living in Them. So, and other yes to the fantasy maps. Someone asked, you know, when are we going to do Neil Gaiman's American Gods? And I think that's a great
question.
We've been lobbying for that for the Mythcard Academy for the free series that Corey does. I've been trying to get that in there. I've been voting for it consistently every time.
Yeah, I'd probably read that.
Will you read the Norse book when it comes out?
I've read it.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So I think Neil Gaiman could be a great. I think we're coming to the point where his work is substantial enough. Besides being genre defining and all those other interesting questions, the work that he does in the myth based material is there's enough there with the Anansi Boys and the extra stories and you can actually have a pretty focused course. One of the problems is he's written so many different kinds of things to just do a course on him. Would be at the selection of, but you could do one on his mythic material, his mythopoeic material, mm-hmm. I think has a pretty solid base there, right? So, yeah, no, I think that's kind of cool. Maybe you're the new Signum movie review team, says Karita. I would do this again, but she's been, to be fair, Karita's been not mocking us through really the whole 2 hours, I think, so. just a warning. And her husband, I think. So.
Thank you for the mockery.
All right, well, good night, America. Are you guys going to keep talking? Do I need to designate another person, or are you out of here?
I don't know.
All right.
I'm going to sign off.
I guess we're making sense after 1 p.m.
Well, it was great. It was great to see you all. You're all just
you
were all names in a in blogs and lists and stuff. So just good to see you kind of more visually. So.
Well, thank you.
Awesome. Yes.
Thanks, everyone else for staying with us.
Okay. Yeah, that's right. I know we're still like 20 people.
Right? Yeah, you guys are hardcore.
This is I can't get this many show for a real class, so this is cool. So we'll see you later.
Bye.
Good night, all.
Bye.